Am I audible now? Yes, to everyone, I hope. Okay, so Ranbir, Rajat are able to listen to me. I hope everybody is able to listen to me. Okay, great, great. Thank you so much for the confirmation. So hello guys, welcome to the Core Java demo session. My name is Abhigya Jha. And here in Way to Automation, I take the Java classes, basically the Core Java, which you are going to learn here. So I hope you guys must have, attended the yesterday session with Rahul Arora. That was the Selenium demo session. So is there anyone who has not attended that particular session which held yesterday? Or everybody has attended the session with Rahul? Yes, no, anything? Okay, great. Okay. So before I begin with the content that I'm going to cover today or the syllabus that we have and what we are going to cover, I'll briefly talk about my experience. So again, I'll tell my name. So my name is Abhigya Jha. I have 8 years of experience working in IT industry. And currently I'm working as a module lead automation engineer. So I started my career as a manual tester for the first 2.5 years. Then later on, I started working in the automation. So I have worked upon Selenium with Java for the web application automation. I have experience in REST API automation using REST Assured and Java. I have experience in JMeter for the performance testing. I have experience in APM for the mobile automation testing. And I also have Selenium Python experience. I'm vastly experienced in Selenium with Python. And I've been taking the Java session here in Way to Automation for last 2.5 years. So I have trained more than 2000 students. As far as the Core Java is concerned here in the Way to Automation. So here I'll be covering the Java session, which will take at least 12 classes, which will be around 6 weeks, Saturday, Sunday, same time, 9 p.m., 2 hour classes, okay? So anything that you want to ask, any doubt you have till now, anybody would want to add anything, would want to ask anything? Yes, Arvas. So Core Java will be taken by me. Are we going to receive assignments? Yes, Rahul, I am going to provide you some assignments for the weekdays, which you have to practice at your own, and I'll be helping you for the solution. Then Arvaz has one more question, and Selenium by Rahul. Yes. So Rahul Arora will cover the Selenium part and I will be taking care of the Core Java. Okay. So in Core Java, I have almost 7 years of experience, and in training, I have 3 years of experience in taking the Core Java sessions. Yes, Ranbir, Core Java is mandatory if you want to learn about automation. Any programming language, at least one programming language you have to be aware of. You have to know at least one particular programming language very well to automate anything, whether that is a web application or API automation or anything you want to automate in testing. You have to have the idea about any one particular language. And here in this course, we will be covering Core Java, because when you will be going to the interview, you will be asked about the Core Java questions in the first round, or when you will be using Selenium to automate any web application. So you have to write code, and that code will be mostly in Java. Most of the company use Java, because Selenium is just an API through which you can handle the web elements. But to perform everything, you have to write code, and that code has to be written in some programming language, whether it is a Java language you are using, or C sharp you are using, or Python you are using. You have to learn any particular language. And for that, Java is the best language, I would say, to learn, because lots of content are available over the internet. Okay. Most of the answers that you will get on Stack Overflow are in Java. So learning Java is very easy. Java is very easy language, and I'll be helping you guys to understand Java very easily. And I guarantee you that very easily you will be able to understand, learn and write code in Java. Okay. Anything else that you want to ask? Okay. So let me start with the content that I'm going to cover here in the session. Okay, Rahul has a question that will this course on Core Java be specific to Selenium? So Rahul, to be very honest, Java is a very, very vast, very big programming language. And in 12 classes, I have to cover most important Core Java concepts. So the topic, the content that I'll be covering here in the class will be specifically designed for the manual tester, which are about to automate or use Selenium for the automation. So that in Selenium, when you are using Selenium for the web application testing, you do not face any challenge while writing code in Java. But again, I'll help you how to improve further. But in 6 week session, 12 class, I cannot cover each and everything, but the topics will be covered. Like I'll cover the OOPS concept, I'll cover the collection, I'll cover the exception handling, I'll cover the string, array, file handling, all those things I'll be covering. Multi-threading I'm not going to cover. I'll be providing you the material for those things. I can provide you few videos that I have covered in some other courses that I can do for you. But in this particular session, I do not cover multi-threading. Yes, collection I'm going to cover. Okay, so let me first write this, the content that I'm going to cover here. So I'll begin with the basics of Java that I'll be covering today. Then we'll talk about the data types in Java. Then I'll talk about the string and string handling. Then the operators in Java. Then all those else, for loop, while, do while, for each, all these loops. Then we'll start with array. Then the complete OOPS concept in detail with practice questions. Then after OOPS, I'll take care of the exception handling. And collections, write it in next line, collections, then file handling. Basically in file handling, we'll be covering the Excel file reading writing, because in automation, like in manual testing also, we prepare the test data with us. Like if we write the test cases manually, in test cases also we write the test data that we are going to use for to execute that those test case steps basically. So see, here in Selenium automation as well, we have to prepare the test data, and most of the people prepare or keep their test data in some file, either in Excel file or CSV file or in a text file or any kind of file. So here in this session, means in this course, we'll be learning how to handle Excel file to read or write something. Also how to handle CSV file to read or write any data from the CSV file. So this I'm going to cover. So these are very in brief that we are going to cover. Okay. At the end of the session, I'll be sharing the complete course content with you guys. Which you can refer to, and you can ask anything if you want to ask. So any doubts, any question till now? Any questions? And be very vocal to me, because being a tester myself, I know the pain of a manual tester and what the hard work you have to do. But believe me, you just need not to be panicked. Just follow my instructions and the assignments I provide to you. Follow those things and you will be easily able to capture or cover the Java sessions. Any doubt? Any questions till now? So right now I have kept all the attendees on mute. If you have any question, you can ping me and I will unmute you if you want to ask any question vocally. So please be very frank and do not hesitate to ask any questions, because I want to keep the session very interactive. So it is a kind of give and take session that you have to be very interactive with me, and I also will like to, you know, get some questions from you guys. So I hope this is okay. Anything, or I shall begin with my questions? Okay, please start. The same Java can be used for API testing. Okay, so I have many questions. So yeah, Vishwanath, we are going to cover the collections, because collection is most important thing. Is it required in collection? Yes, collection is required in Selenium. Can I crack interview after learning? Rajat is asking, can I crack interview after learning? Of course, 100% I guarantee that you will be able to crack interview. But again, the thing that I'm covering here, you have to follow those things. You have to practice on your own. And I'll be providing you the interview questions while taking the session. Also, interview question bank I have with me. So that also I'll be sharing. And I'll be sharing some books and handwritten notes of the complete core Java. Yes, Ranveer, whether you are doing API testing or anything, Java will remain the same. The same concept will be used. Okay. So let me begin with the topic that I'm going to cover. So today I'll be covering the basics of Java so that you are used to and you are comfortable with Java. So this is what I have for you guys for today. So let us begin that what is Java. Okay. So as you must know that Java is basically a high level platform independent programming language, which works on the principle of object orientation. So if you see this particular slide, you will find out few importance highlight in this particular slide, which is high level. The other one is platform independent, and the next one is object orientation. And these are very important things that we should understand why Java is known as high level language. What is high level language? First, we have to understand that particular thing. Then what do we mean by platform independent, and what exactly object orientation is all about? Before we further talk any other topics or concept in Java. Okay, so can anybody tell me what is high level? What do we mean by high level? Can anybody tell me what do we mean by high level programming language? What is high level? Anyone can answer this if anybody knows this. What is high level? Okay, Ranbir is saying English language we can use. Okay, English like language is high level language. Any other thing that is coming into your mind? Anybody can answer. Okay, so I have unmuted you guys from my end. Now you can unmute yourself and you can answer the question, whatever I'm asking. So what is high level language? English like language, rather than saying oops, itself high level. Okay, so let me answer this question first. So high level means basically, if I talk about high level language, high level language means English like language, normal English, which you can at least understand what is written over there. Like if you show you, if I show you some examples here. So earlier what used to happen, if we talk about the hierarchy of the computer language history. So before, like right now, almost every language is a high level language, but initially when the programming language came into the concept, early in the first phase, hardware level language was created. Means whatever language we were using was for a particular machine, for a particular hardware. Then the next thing that came into existence, if I show you here. So first, if I show you the hierarchy, so initially the first was machine language. Then we got assembly language, since we started using assembly language, and now we are using high level language. So what happens in when we were using machine language, all the code that we used to write was written in the form of bits, like in the form of zeros and ones. Like in your engineering, you must have heard about the digital electronics concept. And in digital electronics, you must have learned that everything that your processor does that in the form of bits, in form of 0-1. So when we were using machine language, coding was very, very tough, very, very complex. Like if you see the last point in machine language, say we were using 0-1-0-1 format to write anything. Okay, that was very complex to learn and very complex to implement. And the main drawback of those machine language was that those programs were machine dependent. Means when we are writing any program using machine language, that program will execute on that particular machine only. So what happened then? A next version of language came, and that was assembly language. Like you must have heard about this particular thing. Like in Java, we say int var is equal to 10. So can anybody tell me what this line suggests, that what we are doing here? Can anybody tell me what we are doing here in this particular line? Then you can see here int var is equal to 10. Can anybody tell me what is this int var is equal to 10? Anybody can unmute him or herself and can answer the question.
We assign one value to the integer variable.
Yes. So what here basically we are doing here is that we are storing a value 10 into a variable var whose data type is int. So this you can at least understand that what is written over here. Means if you don't know what we are doing, but you can understand that this is int, this is var, this is equals to, and this is 10. What we are doing, that can be a different thing, but you can at least read this particular thing, that what is written over here. But if we used to do the same thing in assembly language, we have to write something like this: move has 23 comma d4, where d4 is nothing but a register, a location kind of variable, where we are storing 23 as a value, and move is a command to store a value into a location. So this is what we used to do in assembly language. Now when assembly language came into the market after the machine language, it makes the life of the programmer a bit easier as compared to the machine language, but still the life of the programmers were very complex, because again, like writing int var is equal to 10 is much, much easier as compared to this assembly, because we have to use some mnemonics. We have to understand or learn the commands for a particular thing. But when high level language came into the market, everything became very easy. Like the same thing that you are doing here, like by writing move has 23 comma d4, the same thing now you can do like this. So this is nothing but a high level language. High level language means everything that you are writing in the program will be written using simple language, simple English like language, which anybody can at least read. Anybody who know how to read English will be able to read the language. And almost every language that are available right now in the market, all those languages are high level language. Be it Java, Python, C Sharp, Scala, Groovy, Golang, Perl, any language, you name any language, and every language are nowadays a high level language. So any doubt in this particular point, what is high level language? Any doubt till now? I think this is clear to everyone. Yes or no? Please answer the questions. Yes. Saranveer is saying yes. Rajat is also understanding. So there are many peoples also, like Samir is there, Rajatta is there, Vikash is there, Venkat is there. So I believe that everybody is understanding what is high level language now. Or is there anyone who still don't understand what is high level? Please be very honest. Do not hesitate in asking questions. Shall I proceed now with the next point? Yes, okay, thank you. So next thing is platform independent. And now this is very, very important thing which you should understand properly before, because sometimes in interview you can be asked what do we mean by platform independent, and how Java is platform independent, and or what makes Java platform independent. So be very attentive and understand what I'm saying, so that you can answer the same thing in the interview room if you are asked about platform independent. So platform independent of Java means that the class file of Java can run on any operating systems. It works on write one run anywhere principle. So let me make this very easy for you guys. So can you tell me what is the process of writing and running the code in Java? Can anybody tell me what we have to do first? Like first we have to write the code in some file, then we have to compile the code, and then we have to run the code. Is it? I hope everybody knows this, that first you have to write a code in a file, and then you have to compile the code to check the syntax of the code that you have written, and then you have to execute the code to get the output. Yes or no? I hope everybody knows this. Yes? Okay. So let us say, and I'm writing a Java file. I'm writing a Java code. So I'm writing, let's say I'm saying publish class test. Here the name of the class is test. If you don't know what is public, if you don't know what is class, if you don't know what is this curly braces, do not panic. Just be with me. The thing that I want to make you guys understand, that just follow those things. I'll make you guys clear what is this public, why we use public, why we use this class, and why we are using test, and everything I'll make clear to everyone. But just be with me that I am trying to convey here. So what I did, I write this particular code, and I'm writing this code in a file. And currently, if you see this file is nothing but a .txt file. But everybody, I hope everybody knows that in Java, you write whatever code you write, the type of the file should be .java file. .java is nothing but an extension. Like we have many extensions, like .txt we have, .csv we have, .json we have, and then let's say .xml. These are nothing but different file types. Yes or no? Like in Python, you have to write the code in a file with extension .py. In JavaScript, the file type extension of the file should be .js. In PHP, that extension of the file should be .php. So similarly in Java, whenever you are writing code, that code you have to write in a file, and that extension of the file must be .java. So let us say, so currently I am using Windows. What is the operating system of my system? I am using Windows 10 basically. So what I did, I created a file test.java. This file contains some code that I have written, but I have written this file or I have created this file in a system which contains Windows 10 operating system. Okay, so operating system is nothing but OS is equal to platform. Whenever I will be using the word platform, just understand that platform means operating system. So my system contains Windows 10 platform. So I created this file in Windows 10 and then I compiled this file again in Windows 10. And now what I want to do, I don't want to execute the file in Windows. I want to execute this file in a machine which contains Unix or Linux operating system. So what is happening here? The platform it is getting changed. Like I created the file in Windows 10. I compiled the file in Windows 10, but now I want to execute the file in a machine which contains a different platform, like a Unix or Linux or a Mac operating system. So when we say platform independence, it means that we can create Java file on any operating system and we can execute the same file in any other operating system without doing any changes. That what do we mean about by platform independent? Platform independent means you can write the code in any operating system and you can execute your code in any operating system without doing any changes, which means what we say write once and run anywhere principle. So at least you know what platform independent is. How Java became platform independent is a different thing that we will be understanding in few minutes. But now do you know what is platform independent? Platform independent simply means you can write the code in any operating system and you can execute the same file in any operating system without doing any changes. You don't need to have to worried about the operating system that you are using. I hope this is clear to everyone. All this we can do in different operating system. Yes, you can create the file in Windows, you can compile the file in Mac and you can execute the file in Linux. You can do that as well. But the condition here is that all these machines should have Java installed on that particular system. Like if you are using Windows system, you are using Mac and you are using Linux, all those systems must contain Java in that particular system. Then you can do whatever you want to do. Anything else that you want to ask? Any doubt, please ask your question. Any question? I have unmuted all of you. If you have any doubt, you can unmute at your end and you can ask your question. Anybody have any doubts till now? Any question? No, Bhuvika is saying no. Okay, great. Okay, so now let me make you guys understand how Java became platform independent. Any question? Okay. So before I make you guys fall directly to the platform independent concept, let me first tell you how to install Java on your system, how to begin with the Java writing code into Java, because the platform independent, if you want to understand the platform independent concept very clearly, you have to understand the installation of Java for that as well. So let me tell you how to install Java on our system, how to configure Java, what process you have to follow on your machine to configure the Java properly, and then you will understand the platform independent concept very clearly. So what you have to do is just go to your browser and go to Google and say download. Now which version you want to use, you can use any version. Till now I'm using Java 8, so you can also use Java 8 because currently the latest version is Java 12, but you can use Java 8, you can use Java 7, you can use Java 12 if you want, but I would suggest you use Java 8. Okay, that is enough for the testing thing. Okay, so directly type download Java 8. Now as soon as you will be type Java, download Java 8 and you will get this particular, the first link, oracle.com, and go to this particular link. Okay, so first of all, you can see two sections here. One is Java SE Development Kit and one is Java SE Development Kit demos and samples. So you need not to download the demos and sample kit. You have to download the first kit. But can first of all, what you have to do, you have to click on this radio button to accept the license agreement. So I'll click on this radio button. And then please see this very carefully. Let me increase the font size. Here you can see there are multiple packages, bundles available here. But all these packages are specific to operating system. Yes or no? Can you see this? We have multiple packages, but all these packages are specific to operating system. Like for Linux, we have different package. We have a package for Mac operating system. We have a package for Solaris operating system. And then we have two packages for Windows. Can you see this? Are you guys able to see this? Yes or no? Yes. Which means, although Java is platform independent, listen to my words very carefully. Although Java is platform independent, but Java is, for different operating system, we have different Java packages. Because when you will be going to download the Java, you have to download that Java which is compatible with your operating system. Like currently, I'm using Windows 10 and I'm using 64-bit Windows 10. How I got to know that my operating system is a 64-bit operating system? So if you are using Windows, what you have to do, open your My Computer like this PC, right click on this PC and click on this Properties. So you can see I am using Windows 10 and I'm using 64-bit operating system. Okay, you can see here I'm using 64-bit operating system. So if I want to download the Java for this particular machine, which file I have to download? I have to download this particular package, which is for Windows 64-bit, and I have to click on this link. Okay, and as soon as I will be downloading this link, an exe file will be downloaded to my system, which you have to install like a normal software. Okay, I'll again repeat, if you have 64-bit Windows operating system, download this particular file. And if you have 32-bit Windows operating system, download this Windows 86. Whenever you see 86 means it is for 32-bit OS. Any doubt in this? So what you have to do, click on this. So I'll click on this. And the exe file will be downloaded on my system. Okay, then what we have to do, like a normal software, you have to install the exe file. So double click on the exe file. If I show you the exe file, I have the exe file already with me. Let me show you that. Just a minute. No, not is. Let me close this. Yeah, this is the exe file, which will be downloaded onto your system. So you have to double click on this and like a normal system, just click on next and Java will be downloaded on your system. Okay. Now, once the installation is complete, you have to verify whether the Java has been installed successfully or not. And to make sure that Java is installed successfully, you have to follow few steps that I am following here. So once you double click on this, I'll double click on this. So I have already installed Java 8 on my system. run it again. So you have to click on this yes button and then you can click on next, 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 and Windows will be installed on your system. And understand that Java always get installed on your C drive, in Windows C drive. So go to C drive, click on the program files, and you will see this Java folder here. Okay, inside Java you will see two files, JDK and JRE. So whenever you will install Java on your system, you will get two files, two folders basically, JDK and JRE. So now this is a new term for you guys. I must say this is a new term that we are seeing today. So let us first understand what is JDK and what is JRE. Can anybody tell me what is JDK and what is JRE? Anybody? Anybody can answer this. What is JDK or what is JRE? And all these things are linked to the platform independence of Java. So please be very alert and understand each and everything. Okay, Java Development Kit, Vakas. Okay, so Ranveer is saying Java Development Kit. Okay. Okay. Anything, any other answer from this? Java Runtime Environment, JRE means Java Runtime Environment. So now let me tell you what exactly JDK or JRE is all about. So what happens? We all know that in Java, we have three steps that we have to follow to execute any program. First, we have to write a code. The first step is to write a code. The second step is to compile the code. And the third step is to run or execute the code or the program. Yes or no? I hope everybody knows this, that being a automation engineer or being a developer, you will be required to do these three things. Like first you have to write the code, then you have to compile the code, and then you have to execute the code. Yes or no? I hope everybody noticed that you have to write the code, compile the code, and execute the code. Yes, okay. Now when we write the code, we write the code in high level language, like in English like language. Now can I ask you one thing? What do we mean by compile? What we do while compiling a code? What exactly compilation is all about? Can anybody tell me what actually compile is all about? So you guys are unmuted. You can unmute yourself at your end and you can tell the answer. What is compile? Or what is compiling the code?
Changing to the binary form.
Sorry?
Changing the code into the binary form.
Okay. Converting the code into the binary form. Any other answer? Anybody have any other answer? Any other answer? Okay, no worries. I'll make you understand what actually compilation is all about. Okay. Now, we have three-step process in Java to execute any code. First, we have to write the code, then we have to compile the code, and then we have to run the code. Okay. Now, whenever we write the code in high level language. And can you tell me which type of file? In which type of file you will write the code? Can anybody tell me? Like in .java file or in .class file, or in which type of file you will write the code? Okay, great. So you will write the code in .java file. And .java file contains normal English like language which your PC does not understand, your processor does not understand English. Any machine that whether you are using Windows based operating system or Mac OS or Linux or Unix based operating system, our processor does not understand English, because the processor only understand bits 0 and 1, that's it. Processor does not understand any other language. So we cannot execute the .java file directly because the processor will not understand what you want to execute, and the processor will not be able to provide the output to your code. So which means, because to make the programmer life easy, we are using high level language. But ultimately, whenever you are supposed to execute the code, you have to provide the processor the code that the processor can understand, and the processor only understand binary language, 0 and 1 language, 0 1 format. Okay, so what happens, let me tell you first that. So just read this slide very properly. So in Java we have two type of files, or let me first cover this particular slide, how Java code works. So first of all, you have to write a program in Java file, then you have to compile the file using compiler, and then you have to run the file. Okay, so what happens, basically working of Java is divided into three parts: Java compiler, Java interpreter, and JVM. I'll make you guys understand all these things, so don't worry about that. So what happens when you compile the code that you have written in .java file using high level language, we compile the code using compiler. Okay, in Java when you compile any file, any .java file, you will be using compiler. And compiler does two things, I am repeating it, compiler does two things. One, it will check the syntax of the code that the programmer has written, and the second thing that compiler does is, can anybody tell me what the second thing that compiler will do for you? It will convert the file from normal English-like language to bytecode. So the second thing that the compiler does is it converts high level language to byte code. So these are the two things that a compiler does. So again, I'll repeat it again. What compiler does is that, first of all, it will check that the code that you have written, let's say, let me show you one file here. Let us say I have written this particular class. Do not panic what is written over it. Just understand that I created this .java file. So what compiler does, when I will be compiling this .java file, the compiler will check that whatever code the developer has written over here, are those code strictly to as per the grammar or the syntax of the Java's or not. Okay, because Java is, again, I'll repeat it again, Java is a language, a programming language. Now, every language has a grammar. Forget about programming language. Talk about normal speaking language like Hindi, English, French, Spanish, Chinese. All these are languages, and each and every these languages have their own grammar. Like when we speak in English, English has particular grammar. If you talk in Chinese, Chinese language have some particular grammar. Similarly, every programming language have some grammar. And if your code is not strictly as per the grammar or syntax of that programming language, you will not be able to execute that particular code. So when we compile the file, it will first check the syntax of the code, and then it will convert the high level language to bytecode. But again, your processor does not understand bytecode, it understands only machine code, which is in the form of 0 and 1. So when we execute the file, the interpreter will first convert the bytecode to machine code, and then will provide the output. So this is what the workflow of any Java file is all about. So I'll come back to this thing. Okay. Now, can anybody tell me what are the things that as a developer and as an automation engineer you have to do? You have to write the code, you have to compile the code, and you have to run the code. Like you want to write some automation script. So first, using Selenium and Java, you will be writing some script, and then you will compile the Java file, and then you will execute that script to validate the test cases. Yes or no? Yes or no? Please answer. Yes? Okay. Now, understand one thing properly. Let us say, forget about automation right now. Let us say we all, means there are 22 people online and myself. So we are 22, 23. Let's say we all are one team and we are developing one application. Okay. So when we develop any application, we generally have some development environment. Yes or no? Okay, Rajat, you have a question. You can ask your question. Unmute yourself and you can ask your question.
I have one question. Why there's a need to convert high level language to bytecode?
Okay. So different programming language have different approach to this. Like Python, in Python there is no concept of intermediate compilation. In Python you will write the code using high level language and then you will execute the code. And in Python, when you execute the code, at the time of execution, the Python interpreter will first compile the code and then it will execute the code. But in Java, we have three-step process. Like in Python, we have two-step process, write and run. But when you run the Python code, it will first compile, because in every language, compilation happens. Okay. Now come back to this, converting the high-level language to bytecode. Okay. So how Java works is that first you wrote a file using high level language, and high level language your processor cannot understand. So ultimately what you have to do, you have to convert the file which is written in high level language to a machine code which is understandable by the processor. Okay. So what we can do is that directly convert the high level to machine code. This is possible. But your question is that why we are not converting directly from high level to machine code, why we have a bytecode also? Yes or no?
Yes, my question is same.
Yes. So there is no interpreter till now which can convert directly a high level language to machine code.
Okay.
All programming language first convert the high level file to bytecode and then the bytecode to the machine code. Okay.
Okay.
And understand one thing, bytecode is also not understandable by us, means we cannot understand bytecode. We can only understand the high level code that we will be writing in the .java file. Okay.
Okay.
Okay. But in Java, we have three step process. Like first we write, then we compile, and then we run. But in Python or in some other language, you write a code and then you directly run the code. But while running the code, the interpreter will first compile and then the execution will happen. Okay.
Just like Eclipse, right?
Yes. No, Eclipse is just an editor.
Okay.
Means Eclipse just help you write the code. But compilation and execution will happen using compiler and interpreter. I'll make you understand all these things. Don't worry.
Okay, sir.
Anybody have any other question?
So when I compile a C.
Sorry. Yeah, again, ask your question. Yes, ask your question. Unmute yourself and ask your question. Yeah, Vishwanath, go ahead.
So when I compile the C code, will I get anything like intermediate like class file which we get here, but we don't get it in C, or do we get it like when I compile C code using C?
No. So in Java you will get the class file, but in C you will not get the class file, because every yeah. programming language have different approach towards working. Yeah.
Okay, but internally it may happen, is what you are saying, because all programming language will have this, right?
No, understand this thing. It does not mm-hmm. guarantee that every language will have a class file. No, class file contains bytecode, and when you execute the class file which contains the bytecode will then get converted to machine code. But in C or C++, you create the file, and when you execute that, then directly it converts that to bytecode and then to machine code in the same file, not in some other yeah. file. Okay.
So there is nothing like a intermediate
class file. No. In yeah. Python also you will not get the class file.
So the coming to the question which the person asked, right? So what is the need of that file to be generated? The bytecode or the class file which gets generated, what is the use? Probably his question was same, like why okay. the class file should be generated.
To make Java platform independent.
Yeah.
Come to your question. Just be with me, give me 5 minutes and your question will be answered automatically.
Yeah, thanks.
Okay. This question will be answered automatically. Just give me 5 more minutes. Okay. I'll answer this while explaining. You will get the answer of your question automatically. Don't worry. Okay. So I was saying that let's say we are a development team. So generally when we develop any project or an application, we have development environment, then we have a testing environment, then we have a production environment. Yes or no? Yes, okay. So I have one question for you. Let's say we are a development team. So being a developer, what is our task? Being a developer, our task will be to write the code, then compile the code, and then run the code. Yes or no? Because when we develop something, we will write, then we will have to compile, and then we have to test it also on your local environments, on your development environments, or on your testing environment. So being a developer, these are the tasks for us. Now on production machine, can anybody tell me whether on production machine, do we ever write the code, or do we ever compile the code, or we just run the code on the production machine? What happens on the production? What do we generally do on production machine? We just execute the code, okay, right or not? We just run the application on the production. Yes, on production we never write the code. We just run the program. Whatever application we have developed, we just run those application on production. We check, we do some smoke testing and sanity testing, but we do not write anything. So let us say there are two roles. One role is developer and one role is, let's say, client. So being a developer, your task will be to write the code, compile the code, and run the code. But on client machine, we generally run the code. Yes or no? Just run the code. Yes or no? Yes? Yes. So if your job is to write, compile, and run, I'm repeating it again. If your job is to write the code, compile the code, and run the code, then you need JDK on your system. This is mandatory. JDK is nothing but Java Development Kit. I'm again repeating, if you want to write, compile, and run, you want to do all these three actions, then your machine should have JDK installed on your system. This is mandatory. And if your job is only to, run the code, then if you have only JRE, then also the thing will happen. JRE means Java Runtime Environment. So now we are coming back to the JDK and JRE concept, and all these things are linked towards the Java platform independent. Okay. So tell us, tell me one thing. What you guys will require to be installed on your system? JDK or JRE? JDK. Rahul is saying JDK. Rest of the guys? JDK, JDK, JDK. Yes, of course. We have to install JDK because being an automation engineer, you have to write the code, compile the code, and then run the test cases. So you are required to be to install the JDK on your machine. So when you go to Google and you download the file, your machine will have two folders in the Java. So again, I'll repeat, Java always get installed in the program files in C drive. Open the program files folder. You will see this Java folder. Click on this. Forget about this JDK 12. Focus on the JDK 8. So we have JRE 1.8 and JDK 1.8. These are the two folders. Again, I got JDK as well as the JRE on my system. Now inside the JDK, you will again see one JRE folder here. Okay, so let us first understand the difference between JDK and JRE. What is the main difference between JDK and JRE? So let me do one thing. Just understand this very carefully because this is very important. Just a minute. Okay, so let us say I installed JDK on my machine. So let's say this is JDK package got installed on my machine. Okay. What JDK folder contains? JDK contains two important components. Again, inside JDK we have two important components. I'll tell you what are those important components. Inside JDK we have JRE. So if you have installed JDK on your machine, JRE will be automatically installed on your system. So JDK contains two important components. One is JDK and the sorry JDK contains two important components. One is JRE and the second one is development tools. And what are those development tools? Those are nothing but debugger, compiler. These are the important tools inside JDK. Can anybody tell me why these tools are important? Because if you don't have compiler on your machine, how you will be able to compile the code? Yes or no? And similarly, debugger. What is debugger? Debugger is a type of compiler, but the main difference between debugger and compiler is that compiler compile the complete code in a single go and debugger compile the file line by line. A debugger is mainly used for debugging your code. Like let's say you are getting some error and you are not getting why I'm getting error. So if you want to execute the code line by line and if you want to see in which line the error occurs, then you can use debugger. Otherwise you have to use compiler. So JDK contains two important components. One is JRE and the second component is development tools, which contains debugger and compiler. Now what JRE contains is, let us say this is JRE. JRE is nothing but Java runtime environment. Now again, JRE again contains two important component. Can anybody tell me what is the important component inside the JRE? Okay, let me write here. The two important component inside JRE is, the first one is JVM, the most important component of Java platform. JVM means Java Virtual Machine. The second important component are some important libraries. Libraries are nothing but .jar files. Any doubt in this particular thing? Till now, anybody have any doubt? Anybody have any doubt? Any questions? Any questions till now? I'm good. Okay, Prajakta. Great. Now understand one thing. By looking into this particular slide, you can understand that, okay, I'll tell you what is Java, JVM. The duty or the job to execute a file is of GRE. It is the responsibility of GRE to execute the file. Like when you compile the code, compiler come into the scene and it compiles the code. When you run the code, GRE come into the picture and you, with the help of JVM, it executes the file, the code. I'll tell you what is JVM in detail. Don't worry about that. So JVM is nothing but Java Virtual Machine, which creates a virtual machine which converts the bytecode into the machine code and then provides you the output. Okay, so I'll tell you what is JVM. JVM means Java Virtual Machine. And what it does? No, JVM has multiple responsibilities, but in brief, I'll tell you what JVM does. JVM contains, inside the JVM, there is one important component, interpreter. And what you, with the help of interpreter, what JVM does is, first it converts byte code to machine code. And then the second important thing that JVM does is that it provides the basically the responsibility to execute any bytecode is of the JVM, and JVM with the help of interpreter, first it converts the code into machine code and then it provides you the output. So this is what JVM does for you in Java. Till now, anybody have any doubt? Anybody have any doubt? So today's concept is bit theoretical, but next session everything will be very practical, very interactive. But these are also important concepts that which you should understand before, you know, moving towards the next topics like the class and object topics. You should understand these things. So anybody have any doubt in JDK or GRE? You are unmuted. You can ask your question if you have any doubt question. Okay. Okay,
hello.
Yes, yes.
Yeah, so JDK contains JRE and development tools, right? Debugger and compiler.
Yes.
So what is the compiler role is? It execute our .java file and check the syntax error and convert it into bytecode and generate .class file, right?
Yes. Absolutely correct.
Okay. And after that the JRE role comes into picture. It converts, yes, that bytecode into machine code and it provides us the executable file in .java, right?
No, not .java. .java is not executable file. Executable file is .class file. JRE, what it does, okay, using JVM, first it will convert the bytecode to machine code and then your processor, the CPU, will read that particular machine code, and based on the code that you have written, it will provide the output to the JVM, and JVM will provide you the output. Okay. Yeah, okay. Anything else that you want to ask? Because many things are to be, you know, learned here today. Okay, now we are still stuck on the Java platform independent, how Java became platform independent. Now you will understand each and everything. So first, when we went to download the Java, we came to know that for different programming language, sorry, for different operating system, we have different Java packages. Yes or no? I think on this, we are all are on same page. Like for different OS, we have different Java package to be downloaded. And based on the OS that you have, you have to download that particular Java. Yes or no? Okay, great. Now, understand this particular thing. So how Java code works? First, you have to write the code. whenever you write the code, that code should be in Java file. Then you have to compile the code. So when you compile the code using compiler, the compiler will convert the .java file into .class file. It will not convert .java to .class. It will create one new .class file. .class file will contain bytecode. And when you run the code, you never execute .java file. Understand this very carefully. You always execute the .class file. And when you execute the .class file, JVM will come into the picture. And using the interpreter, it will first convert the bytecode into machine code, understandable by the machine, and then it will be executed by the processor, and finally you will get the output. I hope this is clear to everyone. Yes or no?
Yes, so basically interpreter is the part of JRE and compiler is the part of JDK.
Actually, JRE is also a part of JDK. If you see this, JRE is also inside the JDK. JDK does not only contain debugger or compiler, it also contains JRE. And inside JRE, we have JVM and libraries. .jar file. Okay? Because I have told you that if you have JDK on your system, you can write the code, you can compile the code, and you can run the code. So if you want to run the code, you must have JRE on your system. This is mandatory. If you want to execute your code, you must have JRE on your system. And that is why JDK has JRE inside the folder. Okay. Okay. Clear? Great. What are the libraries file under JRE? Rahul, this is a very good question. What are those libraries? What are those jar file? Why do we have those jar file inside the JRE? I'll come to this question in 5 minutes. Just give me 5 more minutes. I'll come back to your question. Okay. So now again, come back to the thing. Let us say we install the Java on our system, and inside the program files, we have the Java folder, and inside the Java folder, I have two folder. One is JDK and one is JRE. Now next step is to set the path of JDK in your system environment variable. Okay, this is very important part that you have to follow. Otherwise, you will not be able to use the Java that you have installed. So next thing that you have to do is that go inside the JDK folder. I am again repeating, go inside the JDK folder and copy this path, the path of the JDK folder. Just copy this path. I'll copy this path and I will store it somewhere. Let us say this is the path of the JDK folder on my machine. So JDK is inside Java folder. Java folder is inside the program files folder. And this program files folder is inside the C drive. So this I have copied. Next thing that I have to do is go to my computer, this PC, right click on this PC and click on this properties. Go to advanced system settings. Now, when you click on advanced system settings, you have to go on advanced tab. Inside the advanced tab, you will see this environment variable button. Click on this environment variable button. Sorry, I was on mute. So when again, I'll repeat it again, click on advanced system settings, then go to advanced tab, then go to environment variables. Okay, I'll repeat it again. So if you are using Windows, go to this PC. Okay, sorry, I was on mute. Okay, so I'll again repeat it. Click on this PC, right click on this PC, go to properties, go to advanced system settings, click on this advanced system settings. Now click on this advanced tab. Under advanced tab, you will see this environment variables, which we have to set. So click on this button. Now here you will see two different sections. One is user variables and the next one is system variables. Now we have to set the Java path inside the system variable section, not in user variable section. Why, I'll tell you, but let me first tell how to set the path of the Java in the system variables, and then we'll tell you why we should not, you know, set the path in the user variables. Okay, I'll tell you, Vishakha, why we are doing this. Just give me 2 minutes. First let us understand how to do that, and then we'll talk about how, why we are doing this. Okay. So what you have to do inside the system variables, click on this new button. Then you will see two labels here, variable name and variable value. So variable name you have to write like Java underscore home. This is exactly what you have to write here. Java underscore home, all letters in capital. In between Java and home, you have to add a underscore. This has to be exactly the same because this is what Java people has recommended to us. Otherwise your Java will not work. So the variable name that you are providing here, you have to write Java underscore home only, and all letters are should be in capital. And the variable value will be the path of the Java JDK folder which we have kept here. So I'll copy this folder path and I will put it here and I'll say okay. So I have already created this variable, so I'm not going to create a duplicate variable, but this is what you have to do. Okay, Dheeraj, you have discussed this, but I'll again discuss it because this is important. Okay, so click on this. So you will see this kind of variable getting created here. Okay, Java underscore home, and the variable value is this. Next thing that you have to do is you have to go to this path variable. Now click on this path variable and click on this edit button. Okay, and once this dialog model is open, what you have to do, click on this new button and say percentage Java underscore home percentage. Basically the variable that we have created with the name of Java underscore home, that variable entry you have to do inside the path variable. Anybody have any doubt till now? Do not worry about why we are doing this, just focus on how we are doing this till now, I mean right now. I hope everybody will be able to do this. Yes or no? No doubt? Okay. So this you have to do, and do not, sorry. Yes, bin we have to add. So here we have to say percentage Java underscore home percentage backslash bin. Basically, if you see the JDK folder, inside JDK folder, we have a bin folder. This path you have to provide here. I'll tell you why. But this you have to do. So I forgot to add the bin. Okay. Thank you for reminding me this particular thing. So this is clear to everyone. Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes. Now once you have done that, just click on OK and okay. Venkat has a question. Do we do this in real time or admin will do it? It depends upon the organization. Most of the time you have to do this. Sometimes admin IT team will do it for you. Prajakta is saying, can you show how to set up Java for macOS? So Prajakta, I do not have Java macOS with me, Mac with me, but you know, today you will receive a mail. In that mail, I'll provide you a YouTube link over there, and that video you can follow to do that. Otherwise, if you still are not able to do that, then tomorrow I can show you over macOS because I have to manage that. Today I don't have Mac with me, but I'll provide you the video which you can easily follow and you will be able to do that. Admin rights required means there are sometimes It may be requiring depending upon the, you know, the policies of the company. Sometimes you don't have the C drive access. In that case, the admin people will do that for you, for sure. But in company where you have the access of C drive, then you can do it on your own. Okay. Yes, Venkat, I got your question. If you don't have C drive access, then definitely admin people will have to do it for you. Okay. This is then their task to do that for you. Okay. Okay. Now I have a question for everyone. My question is that why we are creating Java home variable inside system variables? Why we are not creating that inside the user variables? Can anybody tell me the answer? OS level. Okay, Venkat is saying OS level, yes. So the answer for this is that this is possible that on the same PC, multiple user can log into the system. Yes or no? Like in your office machine, same machine might have different person profile. Yes or no? Like let's say right now Abhigya has logged into the machine. It might be possible that half an hour later some other person can use the same machine with his credentials. Yes or no? So if you are going to add the Java home variables inside user variable, that in that case the user that is logged in right now will that user only will get to use that particular Java. If let's say right now Abhigya has logged into the machine, so if I add the Java home here, only I'll be able to use that particular Java. Any other users if log into this machine will not be able to use that. So generally it is recommended that you should, you know, add the system, the Java home variable, set the system variables. Okay. Yes or no? I hope this is clear to everyone. I hope yes. Now the next question is that why we have to do this? Can anyone tell me why we create this environment variable for Java? Can anybody tell me very quickly, because we are running out of time?
Because to access Java from any of the location on the system.
Okay, so the correct answer is that, just listen to my words very carefully. Let us say forget about Java. I don't know what is Java. I don't want to do programming coding kind of thing. Let's say I purchased a new machine, a new laptop I bought from the market. And I was running some application. So you must have faced this issue that sometimes in some application, that application will ask you to download Java on your machine. Not JDK, but it will ask you to download Java. Until you install Java on your machine, that application will not work. Have you ever faced this issue? Yes or no? Yes. I think everybody faced this problem. So let's say I installed Java at that particular time. Now let's say after 1 hour, sorry, 1 year, I want to learn Java and I want to write code and I want to be a Java developer. So what I did, I installed one more Java on my machine, which is JDK 8, Java 8. Okay. So now I have two different versions of Java. Now what will happen? Any application which are Java based application will require to have Java installed on your system, like Eclipse. Eclipse software has been created using Java language. So if your machine does not have Java installed on your machine, yes, JRE is also, if JDK is there, JRE will be installed. Okay. Okay. So let's say Eclipse is there. JMeter, you must have heard about JMeter. Yes or no? So these are some software which are required to have Java installed on your system. If you don't have Java on your system, those application will not work. Like if you do not have Java installed on your machine, you will not be able to open Eclipse or you will not be able to open JMeter also. So this is why Java is installed. So let us say we have multiple Java and you clicked on Eclipse and you want to open Eclipse. How the Eclipse will come to know that out of multiple Java versions installed on your system, which version to be used? Or let us say you tried to open JMeter tool on your machine. So how JMeter will come to know that which Java version that particular tool should use? So to make Java globally recognized on your machine, you have to do this particular configuration. So that any application which want to use Java should use that particular Java only. I hope now this is clear. Yes or no? Yes, great. Venkat is saying yes. And I hope everybody understanding this particular thing. So this is why this is important. And once you have configured that, the environment variable, open the command prompt and type Java space version. So open the command prompt and type Java space hyphen version. And if you are getting the version here, which means Java has been successfully installed on your machine. And now Java is ready to be used. Basically the Java, JDK and JRE. Got my point? That's why this configuration is mandatory to be done. Otherwise, if the configuration you have not done the configuration, you will, when you will be typing Java space hyphen version, you will not get the Java version written over here. Like, I hope this is clear, guys. Shall I proceed now? Anybody have any doubts? Any doubt? Please proceed. Okay, thank you. Now come back to this slide. How Java became platform independent? Now I'll answer the question of the answer of this question. How Java became platform independent? Yes, you have to configure this. This is mandatory, Ranveer, you have to configure this, okay? Now, not for both folder, only for JDK. Okay, Ranveer, only for JDK you have to do that. Okay? Yeah, great. Only for JDK you have to do that, not for JRE. Now, how Java became platform independent? Now, I'll tell you, I'll give you one simple example. Let us say I created a file with name test.java. Okay. This I have created in a Windows machine. Then I compiled this file. What happens after compilation? What happens after compilation? The syntax will be checked and a new file will be created with the name test.class, okay? And this test.class will contain the code written in the bytecode. Then what I'll do, I'll execute this test.class file. I will run this test.class file. Okay? Is Java compiled plus interpreted language? Please elaborate. Yes, Java is a compiler based language. First you have to compile using compiler and then when you execute the code, interpreter will execute the code. Java is an interpreter language, but here interpreter and compiler are separate parts. Okay, compiler will first compile the code, it will check the syntax and it will convert the .java file to .class file. And then you execute the .class file where interpreter will execute the class file. Okay. Dhiraj. Okay. Now let us say I want to run the code not on Windows machine, I want to execute this on Unix. This I want to do. So can you tell me what I have to do the on the Unix machine, what I should have on the Unix machine?
Jerry?
GRE. Somebody is saying JVM. So JVM is a part of GRE. So at least we need GRE onto machine, onto that machine. So better is to download JDK, install JDK, and you have to configure the path of the JDK on that Unix machine as well. This is mandatory on that machine. Means when we create production machine, on production machine we have to install Java basically, and we have to set the path in the environment variables based on the operating system. The process is different, but the thing we have to do. Okay. Now I have one more question here. If my local machine is a Windows machine, and if my production machine is a Unix based machine, so when I will be downloading the JDK for Unix, which file I have to select there? I'm using I'm downloading using Unix on the production, we have to download any of the Linux compatible Java, yes or no? Yes or no? Yes or no? Yes. Now my question is that why we have different packages for different operating system? Because if we say that Java is platform independent, then why we have different flavors here? Why we have different Java for Linux? Why we have different Java for Mac? And why we have different Java for Windows? Can anybody tell me that? The reason is simple. Understand this properly, guys. Although Java is platform independent, I'm repeating this word, although Java is platform independent, but JVM is platform dependent. I am again repeating this. Although Java is platform independent, but JVM is platform dependent. Why JVM is platform dependent? Because every operating system have different way of processing any command. Okay, so what Java people did is that to make Java platform independent, they created JVM and they made JVM platform dependent. That's why you have different Java packages here. So what happens if I am downloading this Java file, this java.exe file, then on my machine that JVM will be installed which is Windows compatible. If you are installing this Linux file, then on your machine that JVM will be downloaded which is Linux compatible JVM. Okay, where is JVM present? JVM is present inside JRE. You can see here JVM inside JRE. So on your machine that JRE will be installed which is Windows compatible or Unix compatible. But guys, understand this. That Windows or that JVM, that Windows or that Unix dependent JVM can read class file created on any operating system. Like if I created the Java file in Windows and I compile the file in Windows and I'm running the dot class file in Unix, Unix will have JVM, Unix compatible JVM, but that JVM, Unix compatible JVM will be able to read this class file which is created on Windows, and that JVM will convert that Windows created dot class file to Unix compatible machine code. So this is how Java became platform independent using JVM. So the main thing here is that is making Java platform independent is JVM, but JVM is platform dependent. But that platform dependent JVM can read class file created on any operating system. That is the potential of JVM, and that makes Java platform independent, because irrespective of the JVM install on your machine, that JVM can read the class file created on only any operating system. I hope now this is clear to everybody. You guys are unmuted from my end. You can ask your question if you have. I'll again repeat this. The operating system dependent JVM can read class file created on any OS, and then that JVM will be easily able to read the class file, and it will convert that to machine code, and then you will get the output. So I hope this is clear to everyone. Very clear. Rahul is saying very clear. What about the rest of the guys?
Yeah.
JVM is an interpreter. No, JVM is not interpreter. Understand this, Dheeraj. JVM contains interpreter. Means JVM has multiple component inside JVM. Okay. JVM contains interpreter. Okay. And that JVM is platform dependent. Okay. Like JDK, like Java folder contains JDK and JRE. JDK contains JRE plus development tools. Inside JRE, we have JVM and some libraries. And inside JVM, we have the interpreter. Okay. Dheeraj, is it clear or still any doubt is there in your mind? Because be very vocal. This is very important to be understood very clearly. Great. Thank you guys. Okay, and this is how Java became platform independent. And in coming classes, I'll show you the demo how JVM works and what are the things that is happening. And in coming classes, I'll try to show you using virtual machine. I'll create the Java file on my Windows, and on the virtual machine, I'll run that particular file. I'll try to do that for you guys so that you will be able to understand that how JVM becomes platform independent. Okay, these things I'll do for you. Okay. Great. So this is the slide which was very important. Any doubt in this particular slide, or I should proceed with the thing next that we have in the plate. Okay. So next thing after this platform independent of Java, I have this how Java code works. So we know that first you have to write the program, then you have to compile, and then you have to run the program. But remember one thing. Let us say this is my .java file. How many line of code are here? Can anybody tell me? How many hour Java will be covered? 2 hour class will, Java will be 2 hour class Saturday, Sunday. I can understand Dheeraj, in night it is a bit difficult to take the online classes, but you have to be patient. And in coming classes, you will find the class so interactive that you will want the class to go and long and long. So don't worry, just be with me today. Okay, six weekends, 12 classes. 12 classes, at least 12 classes. I'm again repeating, at least 12 classes, because if any doubt, any topic will be left, then I have to take more classes, because I don't want to skip any topics, because all those topics that I'll be covering here, all those topics are important. So I'm not going to skip any topics. I'll try to finish all in 12 classes. If not, then I'll take one or two more classes. Okay. Okay. So can you tell me how many number of line of code are here in this particular .java file? You can see 20 line of code are here. Yes or no? 20? 20 lines. Totally 20 lines. When we total 20 lines. If I count the space and new line, all those things. So 20 line of code. Okay. So understand this. Compiler will compile the complete 20 lines all together. And it will check all those 20 lines are as per the rule, as per the grammar, as per the syntax of Java or not. But Interpreter always executes the code at runtime line by line. Okay. Compiler compiles the complete code altogether in a single go, but interpreter will execute code line by line. Like first it will read this particular thing, that it will read this particular line, then this particular line will be executed, then this particular line will be executed. So Java interpreter executes line, executes the code line by line, and in compiler will compile the code all together in a single go. So I hope this is clear to everyone. Yes or no? Yes. Okay. I'll take more 20 more minutes, and I'll, by 11 I'll wrap up the class. So just be with me for more 15-20 minutes. Next is Java files. So how many type of files we have in Java? We have two type of files. One is .java files and the second one is class file. Okay. So we first create .java file where we write the code, and then once we compile the code, you will get the .class file. But just make sure that whatever file you have with .java extension, like you can see here, many of the .java file are there, child.java, child of firefox.java, firefox driver.java, parent.java, all these are source file. Read it, read here what is written. Source file are simple text file in which we write our code and save them with the extension of .java. So never call the .java file as the class file. No. You should never call the .java file as the class file. No. The .java file, you will always call .java file as the source file. Source file means the file where you are writing your code. Okay. And the once you have compiled the .java, your source file, you will get the .class file, and the file which has extension .class, that class you should call as a class file. Okay. Anybody have any doubt in this nomenclature? This has to be very clear, and interview, do not get confused. No. In interview, you have to make sure that you are calling .java file as a source file. Never call .java file as a class file. This is very important, and these things are, you know, evaluated during the interview, and you will not understand why I've got rejected because you call a Java file a class file. No, Java file is a source file, .class file is a class file. Understood? Everybody? Yes or no? Rahul has a question. What would be called an executable file in Java? In Java, we have two type of files. .java file, .class file. .java file is known as source file. Okay, Rahul? .class file will be known as .class file. And in Java, .class file is executable. .java file is not executable. .class file is executable. And when we create an application, if as the complete execution application to be executed somewhere, we create the .jar file. That you can also call as an executable file. Okay, Rahul? Yes or no? Sure. Okay, great. Now coming to the next slide that I have. KML casing, I'll talk about this KML casing in coming classes. Don't worry about that. I'll talk about this particular slide with you. No, okay. Before I come to this identifier, I have a question for you. Why we need Java? Why we need Java in Selenium? I have a question for you guys. Why we need Java in Selenium? While working with Selenium, why we need Java? Or why we need Python? Or why we need, let's say, PHP or any C sharp? Quickly, can you tell me? Anybody can tell me? To make our Selenium code executable. Yes, to, you know, write the code, and to using the OOPS concept, you can, you know, control the flow of the test cases, because Selenium is just a tool to handle the web application element. Like if you want to click on any button, if you want to click on any link, that you will be able to do using Selenium. But the code that you will be writing will have to be done either using Java or Python or anything. Okay, this is clear, I hope, for everyone. And we also know that Java is a object-oriented programming language. Means in Java, whatever we do using objects. Like we store something, we'll do that using object. We create a method, we'll call that method using object. So everything that is done in Java is using objects. So what happens while we will be writing the code in Java, we'll have to create classes, we will have to create variables, we will have to create methods, we will have to create, you know, files, we'll have to create local variables, static variables, all those things. Yes or no? Why we create class, why we create method is a different thing. But I hope you guys know that you have to create classes, you have to create variables, you have to create methods, you have to create constant variables. Yes or no? Yes. And when we create those classes, those methods and those variables, we have to provide a name to those components as well. Yes or no? Like if we create a class, we have to provide a name to the class. If we create a variable, we have to provide name to the variable. Similarly, if we create a method, we have to provide name to the method. Yes or no? Yes. So in Java, identifiers are nothing but the legal name of the Java components. And those Java components can be variable, classes, method, interface, and constant, which means the name that you provide to your variables, the name you provide to your classes or methods, that name in Java is known as identifiers. Identifiers means the name through which you are going to identify that particular Java component. Like let's say you have a variable. How you are going to identify that particular variable? By the name of the variables. Like let's say you have a friend. How do you identify your friend? You, with his name? Let's say you need to go to your friend's home. How you can go to your friend's home? Using the address of the home? Similarly, how we are going to identify a Java component in Java? By the name of the component, and that name is known as identifier. So anybody have any doubt when we say identifier? What do we mean by identifier? Anybody have any doubt? And I hope everybody is now understand what is identifiers in Java. Bhuvika, Bhavi, Amulya, Akhila, we have multiple people attending this session.
Hello, sir, I have a question.
Yes.
Yeah, so variable Java, for variable, for any variable, identifier is like data type, integer, string.
No. Integer strings are data type which defines the type of the value and the size of the value. I'm talking
so basically,
let's say
integer a equal to 10, so here a is variable, right?
That is like, yes, let's say I'm saying int, let's say name is equal to Abhigya, which is my name, Abhigya Jha. So what is the identifier here?
Name is the identifier.
Yes, name is the identifier. Let us say I created a method here. Let's say I created public void, I'll say addition. So this is nothing but a method. What is the identifier of this method? Addition, the name of the method. Here, what is the identifier? Name, the name of the variable. Got my point?
Sir.
Yes, sir. Yeah. Okay. Anybody have any doubt in identifiers? Hope everybody now have the idea about the identifiers. Okay. Now moving to the next slide. So what next slide says is that we have some rules to provide the name. Like you cannot provide any name to the identifiers. No, there are certain rules which you have to follow. And this slide is the most important slide of today's class. So be very alert and be very attentive. Rules for naming identifier. The first point is that Java reserve keyword cannot be used as an identifier like public, static, void, main, etc. Now, what is reserve keyword? Can anybody tell me what is reserved keyword?
like it is reserved for the particular purpose, like public static void main modifiers, like that we can say.
Yes, predefined. Exactly, Ranbir. Predefined. Yeah. Venkat, yes, your answer is correct. So this is, these words are predefined by Java developer, means the developer who developed the Java language. So these words are predefined, and these words have a different what we say, the aspect, the use. And you cannot use these reserved keyword as an identifier, a name to a variable. You cannot have public as a variable name. You cannot use static as a method name. No, you cannot use void as a class name. No, these are reserved keyword, and you cannot use these reserved keyword as an identifier. And we have a huge list number of reserved keyword in Java. I don't remember everything, but I'll say Java reserve words. And this is the list of reserved keyword in Java. These are all reserved keywords. You need not to be worried about. You don't need to mug up these things. Time and when we will be practicing these things, you will and automatically get all these things. But you can, if you want to remember, you can get this list of Java reserved words. And these words you cannot use as an identifier. Okay? Like in normal life, when we say father, father is a predefined word. Aapko pata, you know why, to whom we call a person, when we call a person a father, when we call a person as a mother. Similarly, brother, sister, all these are predefined things. Similarly, in programming language, we have predefined words which have a special purpose, which have a special use, like public have a special purpose. So these words you cannot use as an identifier. Anybody have any doubt? And I'll give you a heads up here. All the reserved keywords in Java begins with small letter. Remember this point, guys. All the reserved keywords in Java begin with small letter. Okay. This you should means, and Java is case sensitive language. Like, we have a reserved keyword in Java public, and we know that all the reserved keyword begin with small letter. If I use something like this, I'll say int public is equal to 10. This is illegal. This is illegal, wrong. You cannot use public as an identifier because this is a reserved keyword. But if I say int public is equal to 10, this is correct. Because now I'm using capital P, and Java is case sensitive. In Java, small p and capital P are different. So now this is not the reserved keyword, but this wrong one is a reserved keyword. So you have to remember these things, important things. Okay. Second point says that first character of any identifier should begin with either with alphabet character, A to Z, dollar symbol, or underscore. And while using alphabetic character, you can use either capital letter or small letter, does not matter. But for any identifier, whether for a class or variable name or method name or interface name, the first character of any identifier should be either alphabetic character or dollar symbol or underscore. And it says any number or special character is not permitted on first character. Next point says that after first character, other characters can be combination of underscore, dollar, alphabets, and the digits from 0 to 9. And again, special characters are not permitted at any case. So this is very important side, and this is rule, and rules are mandatory to be followed. These are not recommendation. These are mandatory to be followed. So I'll again repeat it. You cannot use reserved keywords as an identifier. The first character of any identifier should be either alphabets, dollar, or underscore. And after first character, you can use underscore, dollar, alphabets, and digits from 0 to 9. I hope this is clear to everyone. Remember one thing. In Java, apart from dollar and underscore, you cannot use any other special character for any identifier. Okay? Got my point? Now we have some assignment here, which we'll practice here only. Any doubt till now for this particular slide, guys? Be very vocal. Yes or no? No doubt? Okay. So before I move towards the next slide, which contains some questions and answers, I'll give you one important aspect of life. Whenever you are learning something, be very involved. Like I'll take one example. In college days, almost everybody, I hope everybody is either has done either BTech or MCA, I hope. Okay. So I think almost with everyone in a semester, whatever our teacher used to teach us, we do not understand anything. But before 10 days of the examination, we understand everything. This used to happen at least with me, that in the complete semester, I did not understand anything of that particular subject. But before 10 days, I understood everything. And I was at least passed in the examination. Why? Because when we prepare for the examination, we get involved in that particular thing. And while taking the lecture in semesters, our mind was somewhere else. So the same thing you should follow here. When you are reading here Java, be very involved. Ask question. Do not take any doubt to your home. No, you should clear every doubt here only, because I'm not there to help you guys 24/7. I'll be available over the phone, over the mail, but it will take some time. So whatever I'm teaching here, do not take any doubts back to your home. Get the doubts clear. Read the things at your home. Then again, if you have any doubt, you can ask. Okay. So this what I expect from you. Be involved. Okay. Be very vocal. Ask question, clear doubts. Okay. So next slide we have is this. It is question time. So we have, let's say these are some identifiers. These can be identifier for variable or for class or for method. Does not matter. But out of these, can you tell me what all are valid identifiers and what all are invalid? So I have unmuted all of you. Unmute yourself and tell me the answer. Do not type on the question section. Just tell the answer over this microphone. The first one, is it valid identifier or not?
Is it valid?
Is it valid? Okay. One answer from Vishwanath, I hope. Okay. Venkat is saying no. Why, Venkat? Why this is not valid? So this is nothing but multiple underscore is there. These underscore. But all together compiled. So Venkat, why this is not valid? Okay, no problem, worries. No worries, Venkat, do not feel offended. Okay. Whatever you have to tell on syntax. Okay. So I'll tell you why this is a valid. This is a valid identifier. I'll tell you why. So the first rule says that you cannot use a reserved keyword. So this is not a reserved keyword. Then the second point says that the first character of an identifier can be alphabet, or it can be a dollar, or it can be a connection character. Connection character means underscore. So you can see the first character that we have here is a underscore. Yes or no, Venkat? Everybody. The first character here is a underscore. And as per the rule, this is a correct one. Yes or no? Yes. Okay. Now the third point is that after first character, other characters can be combination of anything. Yes. So now tell me, Venkat, whether this is a valid or not. First character is underscore. Then we have two, three more underscore. Then we have digits. So now tell me, Venkat, whether this is correct or not. Yes. Yes. Great. Second one. Well, incorrect or not? Valid or invalid? Valid or invalid? Invalid, Venkat, not valid. Second is invalid, Venkat. Second one is invalid. Why? Because The first character that we have here is 0. This is 0. And as per the rule, the first character of an identifier should be either alphabetic character or dollar symbol or underscore. Digits are not allowed on the first character. Okay, Venkat? Okay. Oh, sorry, Venkat. Sorry. Yeah, sorry. I thought you were saying about the second one. Okay, third one, valid or invalid? Valid, Vakas is saying valid. Rajakta is saying valid. Okay, almost everybody is saying valid. Now, the fourth one. Valid, okay. The fifth one. No. Oh, Venkat, right answer, invalid, because we have a dot here. And we cannot use dot, right, Venkat? Okay. So the fifth one is an invalid identifier. We cannot use it. Okay. Great. Sixth one. Second last. Sixth. Valid. Okay. Rajat is saying valid. Rahul is saying valid. Neha, Mujahid. Everybody is saying valid, which is correct answer. First character should be underscore. That is the case. Then you can use anything. So the sixth one is also valid one. Last one, valid or invalid? Valid. Everybody is saying valid, which is a correct answer. Okay. So I hope this is clear to everyone. And you have to follow this. Because in coming classes, we'll try to use invalid. We'll try to, unfollow one of the rules. And you will see that we will not be able to compile the code and you will get the compilation error. So I hope this is clear. Okay. Right. Great guys. And you are learning very easily. Okay. So I hope I should close the meeting right now, because the next thing that I want to cover is will take some time, which will be overflow for you guys. So I hope I should close this meeting right now here only. So again, I'll repeat you guys that do not worried about that you don't know Java. Nobody before BTech, nobody is know Java. Most of the person do not know Java. After BTech, most of the person do not know Java. So don't get panicked. Ki bhaiya mujhe Java nahi aata. I don't know Java. Don't get panicked. Follow my instruction. Follow my lectures. Follow my study materials and follow my assignments. And at the end of the session, after the 15th, 12th or 13th class, I'll ask whether you are comfortable with Java or not. And I hope everybody will tell me that, yes, now we are comfortable with Java. Because being a tester, because I started my career as manual tester, because I did my BTech in electronics. So I did not paid any, interest in the coding things while doing my BTech. Then I got placed in TCS. There I got manual testing job. So I did manual testing for 2.5 years. Then I got to know that there is not much scope in manual. So I moved to Selenium. Initially I faced issue. Then I did practice. And now, right now in my organization, I'm working as a automation lead in my company. And I have also started doing development tasks for the last 7-8 months. I am doing development using Python, but the automation I'm using Selenium and Java. So I have vast experience. Why I'm saying vast experience? Because I have converted myself from manual tester to an automation expert. And I have more than 2000 students that I have in way to automation. This is my third year. So I know the process, how you should convert yourself from manual testing to automation. So the classes will be very interactive. I'll provide you the study material, provide you some books, handwritten notes. I'll tell you the website which you should follow to practice thing. And then I'll tell you at the end of the session, I'll provide you some question banks and programming banks, which will help you to crack interview. Okay. That's it from my end for today. I have the email of all the session. Yes, session time will be same, Ranbir, Saturday, Sunday, 9 p.m. to 11 or 11:30. depending upon the topics. Okay, and I'll continue from here only in the next session. Okay, so I hope this session was very interactive and I hope you guys did not get bored. Anyone who got bored? Because I keep my session very interactive and very energetic. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for your response. Yeah, it will be very interesting. In coming session, you will find the classes more interesting. So this is what I wanted to talk about in the today session. Next session will continue with the same thing. First, we'll cover the Java. Then you will be learning the Selenium from Rahul Arora.